got a Bible this morning, Hebrews chapter 11. Look for the word of God today. Hebrews chapter 11. Everybody will please stand for the reading of the word of God. Can't stand for the word of God. Everybody say amen. By looking at verse 4. The Bible said, by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice to gain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead, yet speaketh. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for today, God. We thank you for the opportunity we have to come together in your house, Lord, to worship you today through your word. And Father, I pray that the word and the spirit would be in agreement. And Father, I pray that you would bless and work and move in this house, God. I pray that nothing or no one will be able to stay the hand of the Lord, God. Father, I pray that you would work it out in this service this morning, God. Father, I pray that faith will be alive. And Father, I pray for somebody this morning, God, who's dead in their sins and their trespasses and doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Father, I pray the grace of God will meet them right where they at, God. I pray the scales will fall off their eyes, for God. I pray that they will come to faith in Jesus Christ today, for the God. Father, I just pray that the glory of the Lord would be known in this service, for the God. I pray the glory of the Lord would be blessed over the reading of thy word, for the God. And Father, I pray that you might use us as a mouthpiece and an instrument to you, God. And Father, I pray that we could sanctify, Lord, the name of Jesus. Hallowed and sanctify the name of Jesus in this house this morning, for the God. Father, I pray, Lord, that we would hold it near and dear to our heart, for the God. Hold it in regard. Father, I pray that we could honor you and respect you, for the God, and reverence the Lord our God. Father, I just pray that you would bless us and use us as only you can. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And amen and amen. Amen. Everybody, please be seated. The Bible says in verse 4, by faith Abel offered unto God. The Bible said in verse 4, by faith Abel offered unto God more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by being dead, yet speaketh. As we look in Hebrews chapter 11 this morning, we find the chapter of faith, the heroes of the faith, and these were recorded by the writer of Hebrews as those that not only said something, those that not only felt something, but those who actually did something for the Lord. Because we know the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 1 and in verse 17 that the just shall live by faith. Because we understand that faith, my friend, is more than just knowing who God is. But faith is pleasing God. Because the Bible says in chapter 11 and verse 6 that without faith it is impossible to please God. We must by faith walk by faith. We must live by faith. That's why we are who we are. That's why we do what we do. That's why we go where we go. That's why we say what we say. Because we are a people of faith. And the writer of Hebrews begins to tell us about those of the patriarchs that were of the household of faith. He tells us in verse 4 and verse 5 and in verse 7 about three individuals. He tells us about Abel. He tells us about Enoch. And he tells us about Noah. In verse 5, he tells us that Enoch walked with God. And he was translated out of this world. He did not take death, nor did he see death. But he was walking with God, Genesis 5 says. And God took him. And Enoch for us is a picture of a man or somebody who walked with God by faith. When you get to verse 7, you find a servant by the name of Noah. And the Bible said that he made an ark to the saving of his house. And what that means is that God called Noah to build an ark. He called Noah to work for him. And Noah went to work for God 6 days a week, 120 years. It took Noah to build the ark of God. And when the judgment of God came and the flood destroyed the earth, Noah and his family were in the ark. And it was to the saving of his household. We see how faith causes us to walk with God. We see how faith causes us to work for God. But it's this verse 4 that God has drawn our attention to this morning in this individual by the name of Abel. Because Abel, the Bible said, made an offering unto God. And it was a more excellent sacrifice, a better sacrifice than his
God received that which Abel by faith gave unto the Lord. And I want you to understand that what Abel did was Abel worshiped the Lord his God. But I would have us to know this morning through the Word of God that faith will lead us to a time and a place and a way of worshiping the Lord our God. Real faith, true faith, life-changing, God-honoring, God-pleasing faith. The first thing that it will do in the life of a born-again believer is lead you to a place of worshiping God, a place of offering and giving back to the Lord our God. I'll turn to Genesis 4 and read to you the account of Cain and Abel. But I want you to understand that at the end of chapter 3, we find where Adam and Eve have eaten of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Sin has cursed them and all of God's creation. They've been put out of the Garden of Eden. Flaming cherubs, swords have been put in the way so that they could not come back in to the garden. The Bible tells us because of their sin that there was thorns and thistles, famine and pestilence and disease. They labored and they sweat, and there was pain and trial and trouble and hardship and suffering because of their sin. God himself had to take animal skins and clothe Adam and Eve just so they could come back into the presence of God, because God is a holy and a just God. We find, my friend, that when chapter 4 opens up, the Bible said that Adam knew his wife Eve. She conceived and bare a son, and his name was Cain. And they said, I've gotten a man of the Lord. The Bible said she conceived again and bare another son, and his name was Abel. And Abel was a keeper of the flock, and Cain was a tiller of the ground. And the Bible says that in the process of time, they come about where Cain and Abel were going to make an offering to the Lord their God. Where Cain and Abel were going to give back to God. Where Cain and Abel were going to worship the Lord their God in the process of time. Listen to me this morning. In the process of time, you need to reflect upon how good God has been to you. How faithful God has been to you. Because in the process of time, God has brought you through things and brought you out of things that nobody else could. And in the process of time, there have been people that have walked away from you and walked out on you, but God has been faithful to you, and God has blessed you, and God has prospered you, and God, my friend, has been your strength and your buckler, your shield and your fortress. But God has been there through the process of time. Praise God. In the process of time, we find where Cain and Abel had surely watched their daddy make a sacrifice, had watched their daddy bring an offering to the Lord. They had watched their daddy, Adam, worship the Lord his God. Listen to me, name of four people on the earth. When you really boil it down, there ain't nobody but Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel. Listen to me, the devil and all his angels done been cast down, but they ain't people, they angelic beings, they spiritual beings, and they roam in the earth. But here, Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, and bless God, they went to church. Bless God, they found a place in their life where they worship the Lord. And I'm sure they watched their daddy make this sacrifice and make this offering. Say, preacher, how have you determined that this is a time of worship in Abel's life? How have you determined that this is an act of worship as an offering and a sacrifice unto God? If you remember in Genesis chapter 22, the Bible says that God called upon Abraham. He said, take thy son, thine only son Isaac, the one that thou lovest, up into a mountain that I will show thee up, and sacrifice him there unto me. Make him an offering was going to make a sacrifice. He was going to make an offering. But Abraham said, we're going to worship, praise God. We're going to worship. Listen to me. Your sacrifice and your offering and how you give back to the Lord is an act of worship and the Lord, your God. Listen to me, the Bible tells us here that Cain and Abel on a certain day, listen to me, there was in the process of time, there's a time of worship. There was a place of worship. But most importantly, my friend, there was a way of worship.
Yes.
And this is where I'm dividing Cain and Abel. Because the Bible says that when Abel made an offering to God, his offering was a more excellent sacrifice unto God. He said, by faith in Hebrews 11 and 4. Listen to me. In this passage of scripture, in Genesis chapter 4, whenever we find that Cain and Abel made this offering unto the Lord, the Bible said that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground, and that Abel brought of the firstlings of his flock and the fat thereof. Whenever Abel offered unto God, he gave the first of his flock and the fat thereof, and Cain brought the fruit of the ground. Listen to me. Whenever they came to God, you get a picture of an altar that's been built, a place where they came to worship. And what they brought to the table, what they laid up on the altar, Cain put his offering there. Abel put his offering there. For one, it's appealing to the eye. For the other, it's a mess. When you consider what they offered, when you consider what they brought as an act of worship to God, many people will look at what Cain brought and say, man, that's a pretty bold fruit. That looks good to the eye. When you look at what Abel brought, you see a lamb that's been skinned and gutted and a bloody mess laying up on the altar. But that's what they brought unto the Lord. For so many people, my friend, in the church today, they want to worship like Cain and not like Abel. Because this is what happened. Whenever Cain brought it and Abel brought it, the Bible said that God had respect unto Abel's offering, but he did not have respect unto Cain's offering. That means that God consumed Abel's offering, because God is a consuming fire, and God and the fire fell from heaven and consumed up that which Abel offered and worshiped the Lord his God with. The Cain was left sitting on the altar. Cain's offering, Cain's worship was not received by God, because there was no connection between God and the altar. There was no connection between God and the worship. Listen to me. You need to understand that God's ways are not your ways. And God's thoughts are not your thoughts. That God's ways are higher than our ways. And God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And bless God, when God said, offer me, God meant very well that you can't come before God without having a sacrifice that is with the blood. Praise God.
Amen.
The blood had to fade away. It was the blood of a sacrificial lamb that Abel offered, one lamb unto God. Listen to me. It was a lamb for every family in Exodus chapter 12 at the Passover when the children of Israel were brought out of Egypt and God delivered them, one lamb for every family. On the Day of Atonement for the nation of Israel, praise God, it was one lamb for a nation. The people of God, as the high priest, sprinkled the blood of that lamb on the mercy seat between the cherubim in the Holy of Holies, praise God. And I'll testify to you this morning, praise God, that over 2,000 years ago, on a hill called Calvary, on an old wrecked bed, it was one Lamb of God, who was slain for the sins of the world. that money could buy your way out of hell. Silver and gold had redeemed you. Peter said that your vain conversation, he said, words, he said, can't redeem your soul from hell, praise God. Your conversation, he said, I can't redeem your soul from hell. He said, my friend, that the tradition of your father, religion, won't redeem your soul from a devil's hell. It took the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, precious is that blood. Oh, precious is the blood that flowed from Calvary, praise God. I want to tell you this morning, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I love that song. Oh, every hope that I have in this old sinful world is anchored in the blood of the Lamb, praise God. By and through the blood, to worship him. You won't worship God except you come by the way that God has prescribed. God's already prescribed the way. You just can't come into the house of the Lord and think that worshiping that you're going to worship God and not come by the way of blood. So what was Cain doing? Cain was doing what so many of us do in our lives. We want to come into a body. We want to come into a sanctuary and we want to worship the Lord, but we don't want to deal with the sin that's in our lives.
Amen.
We just want to come in and worship God, feel His presence, get an emotional high, be blessed in the presence of the Lord, but we don't want to deal with the issues of sin that are in our lives. To the point, my friend, that our offering looks like that of Cain and not that of Abel. Listen to me, not only does the blood of Jesus or the blood of the Lamb atone for us, the Bible says in Leviticus chapter 17 that life is in the blood. Life is in the blood. Listen to me, not only Jesus died for our sins, but He came to give us life and life more abundantly. And what we find with Cain's sacrifice is the dead sacrifice. It's the lifeless sacrifice, praise God. There is no life because there is no blood. Listen to me. If you have not been washed, I know this sounds real churchy. But if you have not been washed and cleansed in the blood of Jesus, then friend, you have not entered into a place of worship with the true and the living God.
Yeah, bro.
If you have not been washed and cleansed and sanctified and justified with the blood of Jesus, you do not, cannot, and have not worshiped the true and the living God. Because this is where the rubber meets the road. You have to do more than believe in God. You have to believe God.
Come on, bro.
You have to believe God. By faith, Abel made an offering unto God. Abel believed God. He watched his daddy make that offering. He watched his daddy bring that sacrifice. He watched his daddy at the stains of his sins were atoned for. And he was cleansed and covered with the skin of an animal. And the blood of that animal covered. I'm telling you today, my friend, he watched him to the point that he believed that what he did for his daddy, that God would do the very same thing for him, praise God. Listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says in verse 4, and unto Abel he also brought the firstling of his flock and the fat thereof. Listen to me, when he brought the firstling of his flock and the fat thereof, he brought the first that he had and he brought the best that he had. He brought the first that he had and the best that he had, and he kept nothing back from God. He gave everything to God up on that altar. Listen to me. Cain brought some of his fruit. He brought some fruit from the ground. He didn't bring bring the storehouse, he brought some fruit. Put it up on the altar. But whenever Abel brought, listen to me, whenever they made a sacrifice, an offering, worship God in the Old Testament, you don't hear him saying that they took and quartered the lamb and laid a leg quarter up on the altar. You don't hear him saying they cut off one of the lamb's arms and laid it up on the altar. You don't hear him saying they cut the back strap out and laid the back strap up on the altar. No. Whenever they made a sacrifice and they worshiped the Lord their God, they laid the whole thing up on the altar. What I'm trying to tell you this morning is that the Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 12, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable before God. He said that is your reasonable service, praise God. Listen to me. Ananias and Sapphira kept that part, and you see what it got them.
Amen.
Ananias and Sapphira kept that part, and the Holy Ghost healed them. Listen to me. We would do well to put ourselves wholeheartedly up on the altar as a living sacrifice unto the Lord our God. Then when we give God our first, we give God our best, and we give God our all, praise God.
Yes.
Do you remember what God said to the church in Malachi? The church in Malachi. Malachi is the last book in the Old Testament. Whenever they started talking to him at Malachi, God told him, he said in chapter 1, he said, y'all might as well close the doors and go home. I'm going to tell you what Mickey said. Mickey, if you read it through, and transcribe through Mickey, you say, he just said, shut the doors and go to the house. Because literally that's what God said. He said, because I don't want your stale bread, your moldy bread, your polluted bread, because I don't want your blind sacrifice, your lame sacrifice, your disease sacrifice. He said, I know who I am, and I know what I deserve. Where is my honor, is what God said. He said, you bring in the lame, and the disease, and the sick, and the polluted, and the molded, and the bread up in my house, offering that up to me. He said, I deserve better than that, thank God. Ain't I been with you? Ain't I provided for you? Ain't I made a way for you, praise God, out of no way, praise God? Didn't I redeem you and call you by name? Don't you know that you are mine, praise God? The praise of God ought to be on your lips, praise God. The joy of the Lord ought to be your strength, praise God. Praise ought to be a priority in your life, praise God. The praise of God ought to be bursting forth out of your lungs this morning because of what God has done for you. I'm telling you, friend, we ought to be praising God, blessing and worshiping the Lord up in this place this morning because how good God has been to us. Amen. The Bible said in verse 5, but unto Cain and to his offering he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. Now listen, the Bible said, and to Cain and his offering he had not respect. That means God looked at it, he saw it, and he said, I don't want it. I don't want it. I don't want it. First of all, it's not my way. Lord Jesus. I'm gonna have to get Cain the benefits of doubt this for me. Because I think we're more like Cain than we want to admit. Because I see Cain. He is a tiller of the ground. He's been working hard. It's hard to see. He's trying to get it all in. He's out there working early in the morning, late at night. Can't anybody that's ever been busy, can't be busy. Can't so busy, it really ain't got time to go get this offering and make it to God. Can't so busy that he just kind of put something together
and says, here it is, Lord. With a spirit and an attitude that says, God, you know how tired I am. God, you know what all I had to do. God, you know how busy I've been this week. And God, I really ain't had time to talk to you or meet with you or even ask you, what do you want? So he asks, he brings that offer. And I can just hear God speaking to Cain. Cain, you're going to have to do better than this. Cain, you're going to have to do better than this. But Cain said, but Lord, you know how busy I've been. Lord, you know everything I had to go on and all I've been doing this week, Lord, I work late, I died early. And Lord, you just need to be glad I'm here this morning, Lord. That really, if you want to get right down to it, God, I just want you to know I'm glad to be here, but Lord, you need to be glad I'm here. But it took a lot for me to get here this morning. It took a lot, Lord, for me to get up in here. I don't think we've ever been busier at a time in the history of this world than we are today. We are the busiest people that there ever has been.
Amen.
Listen to me. The devil will use business as a tool, as a tactic. Listen, business is not a spiritual gift. There are a lot of people who think they have to be busy, that they need to be busy, that if they're not busy, then something ain't right between them and God. Whenever somebody called you on the phone, when was the last time somebody called you on the phone and you were dead barrel honest with them and said, I'm laying on the couch taking a nap? Most times you'll say, man, I'm so busy. I got so much going on, I don't even know my head from my toes. I can remember when I was a little boy, that was the same. They say, when I was a little boy, you've been in a one-legged man and a butt-kicking contest. Yeah. Remember that? Been in a one-legged man and a butt-kicking contest. That's pretty busy.
Yeah.
But I think we're pretty doggone busy today. Yeah. And the devil feeds us busyness so we don't have time for the Lord. Yeah. He feeds us busyness and he keeps us so busy and things that are not really that significant or things that don't really matter in the grand scheme of things, but we think that we got to do it, praise God, because we take pride in being busy, praise God.
Yeah.
Anybody in here busy?
Oh.
We so busy, praise God, we can't even get God the first day of the week. I'll be honest with you. We so busy, praise God, we got to check every email we got before we come to church on Sunday morning. We just too busy. We just too busy. The Bible said in Luke's Gospel chapter 10 that Jesus came to a certain village and the Bible said he went into the house of one named Martha and she had a sister that was called Mary, the Bible says. And the Bible says that he went into the house, he and his disciples, and the Bible said that Martha was cumbered with much service. Let me tell you what busy will do for you. Busy will put you in a place of burden, praise God. Busy will cover you with a heavy load. Busy will put you in a place, my friend, where you are bowed over and bowed down. And the devil just puts it on you, keep putting it on you. And you can't find no relief. And you can't find no help. And everything's a mess. And you can't get out from under the load of busyness, praise God. She was cumbered with much service. But the Bible said that Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus, receiving or hearing his word. Listen to me. The Bible says that Martha stuck her head out of the kitchen and said, Jesus, you're not going to send Mary here in this kitchen to help me. He said, Martha, Martha. He said, thou art troubled. You said, you are careful and troubled about many things. Listen to me. To be careful is to be worried. To be troubled is to be troubled. He said, Martha, you worried and troubled, and that's what busyness has done for you, Martha. Let me tell you this. I believe that Martha had good intentions. And I'm not saying busy people don't have good intentions. But busyness will take you away from God.
Busyness will take you away from the feet of God. Busyness will take you out of the presence of the Lord, where you really need to be, so that you can receive what Mary received. Mary had chosen the good part. I have people in the office, preacher, I'm too busy to go to church. I'm too busy to serve the Lord. I'm going to get to a place where I'm going to retire one day. I'm going to get to a place where I don't have all this going on. And I don't know. Listen to me, you'll be so much more busy when you retire than you was when you even had a job. If you're going to serve the Lord, you've got to make up your mind to serve the Lord now. If you're going to live for the Lord, you've got to make up your mind to live for the Lord now. And break down all this busyness. That's your fault.
Yeah, it is.
99.5% of it belongs to you. It belongs to you. We create busyness. I can just picture Martha. I can picture Martha. She said, in the kitchen, she said, Mary, Jesus and the disciples come. You know Jesus. Jesus' favorite is pot roast and potatoes and them little bitty carrots. I have got to cook that for Jesus. Mary said, that's all right. I'll help you do that. She said, but wait a minute, man. You remember Peter. Boy, Peter likes cracking cornbread and turnip greens. We have got to fix Peter some cracking cornbread and some turnip greens. And they said, I don't know about that. Now, I'll help you fix something for Jesus, but Peter, he might have to eat pot roast. He said, but now you remember Judas. He likes that crop pie. He got to have that crop pie, that strawberry pie, that jam all in there. He got to have that. You know, Judas, we're going to have to fix Judas that. Mary said, I'll help you fix Jesus some pot roast and some potatoes and some carrots, but I ain't worried about no crop pie for Judas, and I ain't worried about no cracking cornbread and turnip green for Peter, praise God. But Martha went ahead and did what Martha wanted to do and created more work for herself than Martha was able to do. And it took her away from the Lord. The busyness that we find ourselves consumed with in this life so much is not what God has called us to do. Not where God has called us to serve. But it's what we ourselves have got ourselves into. Can you just be busy? Can you just be busy? And when you made an offering to God, it wasn't the right offering. There's the right offering and the wrong offering. There's the right way and the wrong way. There's one that's accepted, one that's rejected. One that's respected and one that's not. And whenever God didn't receive his offering, the Bible says the kingdom. And his countenance failed. He got mad. I'm telling you, Cain was ticked off. Cain with that other word off. He was mad. He was real mad. He was so mad that angry in his heart toward God and his brother. Listen to me. If you, as a born-again believer, make up your mind that you're going to offer to God the right way, the right thing, in the right place, at the right time, and it's going to honor God and glorify God, and you're going to worship God by that which you bring to Him, because He's worthy of your worship, you better know that there's going to be a whole lot of Cains that are going to get mad at you. Yes. There's going to be a whole lot of Cains that are going to get mad with you, frustrated with you, ticked off at you, and they ain't going to like you anymore, and they're going to say, don't take all that. You need to sit down, sister. But I tell you this morning, you need to worship God like you know who He is, praise God. Like you know what God has done for you, because besides Him, there is no other. He was mad and angry. He was depressed. He was discouraged. He was discouraged so much so, my friend, he didn't even want to be around God or be around Abel. He didn't want to have nothing to do with either one of them. Listen to me. Have you ever thought about why? I mean, really, let's boil it down for just a minute. I'm going to come to a close. Have you ever felt like why he was mad? And why his countenance fell? Because God didn't receive his worship. Could it be the reason that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday are so messed up and things ain't working out? And we get so mad and so frustrated and so discouraged. And sin is ruling in our life. Because we didn't get our worship on right.
Amen.
On Sunday. He said, God, give God the first. Is this not the first day of the week? Sunday is the first day of the week. If we could give God our first and offer our first to God and worship God on Sunday, I can promise you, if you will worship God in spirit and in truth, and you will worship God like God deserves to be worshiped, and you will fall on your face, and you will honor God and extol the very name of Jesus and magnify Him and worship Him from your heart, pray God. I'm telling you today, if you will worship God on the first day of the week, then bless God what God won't do on Monday. Without that way, anybody will stand to you.